So this year, I will conduct a one-year research project, Troglopy, under the supervision of Marie-Laure de Raz. This project will start in October. It is funded by DIMMAP and ANR Etio CRIS process. This project is being carried out in partnership with three research teams and one private company. The aim of this project is to better understand the Christian medieval societies in the northern part of Ethiopia, the region of Tigray. Because most of the writing sources are lost, rock-hewn churches are first-order archival material for assessing the socio-economic status of the Christian rural communities active in the area. So as you can see here, this is the area where we will start the project, and the main city is Awzi. The Ethiopian rock-hewn churches were mostly studied by art historians in the 70s and 80s. Researchers published inventories of churches and some general geological considerations were made. It is in 2010 that a French team of archaeologists and historians proposed some reflection on the occupation phases of the famous site of La Libella for the first time. This team, supervised by Marie-Laure de Raz, will publish its results this winter. For the Tigray region, another French team, led by Claire Bostiessé and Sigrid Mirabeau, is focusing on one site, Korkor. They are studying frescoes, geology, and conservation of the two churches of Korkor. This is the main churches, Mariam Korkor. As you can see, it's on the top of the Imba. Imba is a hill. The region of Tigray is located in the northern part in Ethiopia, as I said, and not far from Eritrea. The region has two seasons, one raining season in July and August, and one dry season. The climate is desertic. Inhabitants have not extensive cereal cultivation. The geology could explain the lifestyle of its inhabitants and the choices to carve their worships in the rock. The subsoil, dated from Precambrian period and formed by gneiss, slate, and mica schist, Ordovician and Jurassic sandstones cover the first stage. It is inside these sandstones that the rock-hewn churches are mostly carved. So, yes. This is sandstone, Ordovician sandstone here. So, as you see, you have a lot of place where you can find sandstone here in Ausen and another area close to Adsby. As you can see, the region of Tigray has a rich history. During the antiquity, the Empire of Aksum developed trade connection with Roman Empire and sub-Arabic communities. In the 4th century, the king of Aksum became Christian. Christian communities are monophysites, they followed Coptic rules. On several occasions during the medieval times, Christian kingdoms struggle against Caliph's armies because some Muslim communities have settled further south. So the communities, Muslim communities is here and here in green, let's say. Not far from the Christian kingdom, some pagan communities continue to build megaliths. The famous one is the Shay culture. Here. That is why to build and to carve churches is one of the most important acts for the king. By this, the king ensures his power and marks his territories. A huge architecture change seems to happen before the middle of the 17th century. From rectangular in plane, the churches become round. With the change, archaeologists and art historians can presume that the basilical plane is reserved for the medieval period. To conduct the Troglodyte P project, the team will mainly focus on two sites, the site of Degun and of Mariam Yerifada. These two sites face each other. Degun is carved into a plain, and the Mariam Yerifada church is carved on the top of the hill. The Church of Degun is the main monument we choose for the project. It is a monument de vallée, monument of the valley. It was carved inside a rocky protuberance. It was well studied on several occasions, especially by Claude Lepage in the 70s, who devotes two full articles to it. He described each monument and architectural elements, draw plans and cross sections. The site has three rock-hewn monuments, an hypogean tomb, and a baptistry carved on the top of the hillock. Degun A is located around 30 meters to the main building church, where Degun B and C are carved. The building of the main church has been built during the modern time and probably at the beginning of the 20th century. As you can see on the plans, Degun A and B seems to have the same shape. They open by a vestibule, then a rectangular room with pilaster follows. The last part is tripartite, with a window opened on the east wall of the central room, called the Baldenquin room. Degun C has two rectangular chambers and a deep alcove without soil, which is overhanging the entrance of the tomb. This is the room without soil, the entrance of the tombs and the tombs. The tomb is reached thanks to a stair and has three loculi. Because of the organization of the site, Claude Lepage proposed to identify the group C and A as funeral churches. Some carved decorations could be clues to date the site. Square pillar, 3 degrees capitals, door imitating wood door jamb, inset and re-entrant facade. According to Claude Lepage, these decoration features are a copy of the Axumite style. Wood and stone are the traditional Axumite material used to build warships, temple or church, or elite buildings. However, these imitations of Axumite architecture only lead us to suppose that the site was carved between the 10th and the 14th century. The localization of the site on a plain is remarkable. Indeed, most of the rock-hewn churches in the Tigray region are located on the top of the hill. Three churches only seem to carve into an outcrop. They are called, as I said, Église de Vallée, and opposed to Église de Montagne. This type of church was identified as a funeral church and is still considered as the oldest example of the rock-hewn church in the Tigray. Mariam Yerifada is known by several scholars, but it is not published yet. That is why I cannot show you a plan of the church. The little church is carved in the sandstone on the top of the imba. As you can see, the entrance of the church is destroyed and rebuilt with concrete. We don't know when this restoration was made. The church has an apex, a rectangular nave, which is divided into three by two range of square pillars. The eastern part is the Magdash, the Holy of Holies, where altars belong. One room is still being dug to north of the church. Close to the monastery, a holy spring is renewed for its curative qualities. The decoration is cut carelessly than they go. We recognize the square pillar and the patterns of one square inscribed inside a bigger one. Two other motifs are characteristic, the so-called Aksumite frieze, which is a copy of wood decoration, and the capital with a tray lying on the small cushion. This decoration pattern and the basilical plan are indications to qualify the church as medieval. Two distinctive features need to be noticed. The church has two entrances, and the narthex is carved inside a huge vault. Nowadays, the church is parochial, but it seems that before, it was only a catholicon of the monastery. Look, after this general assertion, let's focus now on the project, Troglopy. Troglopy has three directions of research: geology, traceology, and ethnography, which will help us to answer three questions. Where the church is carved? What are the techniques used to make them? Who took part in the building process? Geology is an important point to understand the techniques of carving process and choices of stone cutters. Last year, I gave the example of Rockhewn Church in Cappadocia, Guillemets 4b. Inclusion stopped the building process of the church and the master plan has to be changed. The church became a small chapel with a basilican plan instead of a big church with a transversal plan because of the geology. This direction will be conducted by a team of the University of Orsay, GeoOps. They will perform petrological and structural analysis to understand how the stone could be reacted to the tool. Because the two churches are not carved inside the same eye, we will verify if the nature of the sandstone is the same. Traceology can be seen as a kind of building archaeology, but instead to observe stones, we analyze tool marks. This technique helps to study the carving process and to establish a relative chronology, define occupation phases, etc. Basically, I will try to see if the techniques used in Lalibela is also applied in the region of Tigray. In Lalibela, workers were starting the carving process by a window, located on the top of the wall. According to Luke Stevens, we can make out this technique because these kinds of windows are not decorated. After being entrenched into the rock, they realized a room and began the carving process. This technique is used for a church with a high roof. But in the case of Mariami Refada and Degum, it seemed that they chose another technique to start the carving process. With the help of IGCAV, the private company, I will also try to propose a new technique to read tools mark using a 3D laser scanner. This technique will show the layers of the tool marks. Ethnography has an important part in this project because the particularities of Ethiopia are churches are still used and monks know legendary of construction. Some stone workers continue to carve churches with traditional techniques, I mean without mechanics and machine. This direction will be managed by Alai Atzba, University of Adigrat, Eric Gontier, National Museum, and me. Several interviews of craftsmen were conducted in 2010 by Michael Jervers from Toronto University. In addition to these kinds of interviews, we want to meet some quarrymen who extract sandstone. They can also have relevant information about carving process and techniques. Troglopy is a multidisciplinary project where archaeology will meet geology and ethnography. It involves three main institutions, CNRS, National Museum of Natural History, and Orsay University, and IGECAV. Above the specific questions for each discipline, Strogropy raises two main subjects: transmission and non-transmission of unique knowledge, where this practice came from, why medieval Ethiopians choose to shape the rock. And the second one is Christianization of Ethiopia by studying medieval societies through their activities. In the future, we hope to continue this research in Ethiopia and enlarge our scope of other regions like Valaka, or to other civilizations like pagan civilization who lived in the same time for that Christian communities. Thank you.